Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm so glad you're here. My name is Kelsey Derringer, and I am the Professional Development Coordinator for Bird Brain Technologies. That means I get to work with teachers all over the world, helping them bring robotics to their students in whatever form that takes, which, as we all are aware now, can take many forms. But we have some really special guests with us today, some teachers who are going to be our resident experts and share with us their experience of bringing Hummingbird to their students in a virtual space. So Melinda, would you perhaps start off and introduce yourself?
Hi, yes, my name is Melinda O'Neill. I'm the summer programs coordinator at Gwynedd Mercy Academy High School, which is right outside of Philadelphia. And I was lucky enough to work with Tina Connor this summer on a Hummingbird's summer camp that we ran. And we had it with middle school girls. So the high school that I work at reaches out in the summertime to have students who could possibly come to our high school. So that's why we were really focusing on middle school girls and robotics.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being with us today, Melinda. Christina, would you like to introduce yourself as well?
Sure. My name is Christina Connor. I am a former teacher at Gwynedd Mercy Academy High School, where I taught AP computer science principles and started a robotics team there. Currently, I'm sort of freelancing, working on providing opportunities for specifically middle school girls and other underserved communities to expand their STEM skill set. So the Hummingbird Camp was something that really resonated with me and that I was very anxious to do.
Fantastic. I'd like it also, if we could have just one other person introduce themselves. Aparna Brown is here from Bird Brain as well. Do you want to tell folks what you do at Bird Brain and how you connected with these folks?
Yeah, so hello everyone. My name's Aparna and I am the Director of Operations at Bird Brain. And what that means is I do a little bit of everything. So a lot of you probably don't know this, but we're a tiny little company, only single digit numbers of employees. So pretty much everyone does everything. But I've emailed and talked with a lot of you over the years in various different roles. And I met both Melinda and Christina through the Finch Robot Loan Program. Mm-hmm. So they both, in various different roles they've had, have borrowed our Finch robots and introduced them to their students. And they were fantastic ambassadors of the Finch and of computer science. And so we were super excited when we found out that they were doing this virtual camp. And they're being a little modest when they talk about it, because really they pivoted extremely quickly. And I'm sure all of you on this call are thinking about the same kinds of pivots, that every day someone is asking you to do something different. So they really are role models for that. When they told me they were doing the camp, I looked up their camps online, and there was nothing about a virtual camp. It was all about the camps that they had planned, like everyone else, to be in person. Right. And so they really pivoted quickly and did a fantastic job. So I'm really excited to hear from them. I will be in the chat. So if you have questions about what we're talking about or just about Bird Brain, Hummingbird, Finch in general, pop them in there. I'll send you links, answer questions, and help rise questions up to Kelsey, Melinda, and Christina.
That's right. So the first thing I want to do is get us all on the same page, figuratively, and also kind of literally. I created a bit.ly link here that will open up a case study that Melinda and Christina and the Bird Brain team worked on to create together. And so this is on the Bird Brain site, but you can go to bit.ly. And then remember, capital letters matter in bit.ly links. So GMHS case study. And we'll drop that, if you wouldn't mind, Aparna, we'll drop that in the chat as well, so that anybody who's here on the Zoom link, you can click on that from the chat. So GMHS case study. And where that will take you to is an online PDF that is a write-up of everything that Melinda and Christina did and some of the greatest successes, greatest challenges that they faced in doing this camp. So I'll go there now, I'll show you what we're looking at. So here's this case study. So you can kind of read about their process, some recommendations they have for distance learning, some of their biggest challenges, successes, and then their teaching sequence, exactly how they did what they did. So that's actually where I want to start, and kind of what Aparna was talking about. So Melinda or Christina, whichever of you would like to answer, tell us about what the plan was and then what the plan became, and tell us a little bit about that process of turning from a physical camp into a virtual camp. How'd you do that?
Linda, how about I'll start and you can fill in where I'm missing. We planned a long time an in-person camp. It was supposed to be how to be an entrepreneur. And then COVID came along and it got canceled. And I won't lie, but I'll say that we did try for a while to try to fit that square peg into that round hole. How can we teach, how to be an entrepreneur virtually? And it was just like, it was awkward and it didn't seem it would be very effective, nor did it seem like it would be very much fun to try to translate that to virtually. And instead of trying to mimic an in-class experience, we came to the realization that why don't we do something virtually that sort of celebrates what you can do virtually that better than what you can do in the classroom. So we started thinking about what are the things that we really like to do? We've worked together coaching a robotics team in middle school, and we both like that whole process of figuring out how to solve something or to make something happen. And I had experience with the Finches, as Aparna mentioned, and so did Melinda. But Melinda had a couple of hummingbird kits at school, and we were like, that might be interesting. So we talked about what could we do with that, and slowly but surely came up with this, not so slowly, but pretty quickly we came up with the plan to have sort of it wasn't called a robotics camp, it was called Pechakucha, and in Japanese, if I have the translation correct, it means chit chat. Yeah. So we wanted to have a camp that the girls would come to have an informal exploration of robotics, but learn something new or someone new every day. Like when they leave, they have learned something. Mm-hmm. So that was sort of the premise. Other than that, there was really no theme as far as, where this camp was going to go, except for that we were going to introduce robotics and maybe have them make something. Yeah. And it turned out to be a great experience. Linda, am I missing something?
No, the only other thing about the camp was that it was a very reduced price camp. It was $40 for an in-person week of camp. And that $40 was really we were gonna buy them pizza and cake. I was responsible for being I want to make sure you get your money back, but then I want you to come to this other camp. So if we had 15 girls registered for the in-person camp, we contracted all those parents and said, this camp's going to be virtual, but it's going to be free. And we want to see if you can come. So of those 15 girls, we had 10 register then for the virtual camp.
That's mm-hmm. wonderful. That's wonderful. And something that I love about what y'all did too, is you didn't say, okay, well, we're just gonna turn this into a robotics lecture for a week. You're from the get-go, the foundation, you based it on Pechakucha, which is, chit chat. If you haven't heard of Pechakucha as a kind of format before, definitely take a gander on Google about that, because it's just a really cool way to approach learning, less of a lecture and more of people sitting in a circle kind of teaching each other something. So I think that was a really cool approach to this. So can one of you speak to what the structure of the camp was? How many students, what were their ages, and then how often and for how long did y'all meet?
We had 10 girls, like Melinda said. We met 9 o'clock we called it a flexible end time of 10:30. If they wanted to stick around, we were willing to do that. We started each day, one thing I just will backtrack a little, because this was free and these are middle school girls, these are not our high school students, they had no obligation to Melinda nor I to stay. And we wanted them to come back every day. So we were a little bit loose on the structure. We tried to make it fun by we had a secret square, and whoever was sitting in the secret square got a prize for that day. So we figured they'll come back to see if they're in the secret square. And then when they returned the hummingbird kits that we lent to them, that's when they got their prize. So we were hoping there was some motivation to return the kit, in good condition.
That's actually something I want to ask y'all about at the end, of just little tips and tricks like that, because those things, those are seasoning. Food is good, but it's so much better with all that stuff in it. So I want to make sure that we save some time at the end for you guys to share all your seasoning there. Yeah.
Sure.
If you can tell us a little bit about the structure and format of the camp.
We started the day with the secret square. And does anybody have anything, did you make something yesterday after class that, did you bake something? And trying to get them to engage, because that was sort of one of the motivations, was for them not to just, engage with Melinda and I, but to maybe make a friend, and that what is so lacking sometimes with a virtual experience is the interaction with kids your own age. We started out with a microbit classroom with the simulation. And this was a good opportunity to assess their skills. Though we did send out a survey in the beginning to sort of see what devices students were going to be using, what their experience with programming was. We had rising fifth graders through rising eighth graders. And the younger girls made up the majority, I think, of the 10. Mm-hmm. So we did the simulation first and invited the girls to change the code. It was a way of introducing them to the blocks. And then they got to share what they did to edit or alter the program that I had presented to them. And then each day we just moved a little bit closer to, programming is a lot more fun when it's three-dimensional, and showed them a sample of a robot that I had created, and invited them to manipulate the code. And then using your brilliant hack, you and Matt's brilliant hack, we were able to apply their code to the robot, and then they went on to build their own.
And for folks who haven't experienced it before, I just want to kind of show you what Microbit Classroom is, what it looks like. If you're familiar with MakeCode as a programming language, it's basically like that. This is what the student sees. So they can drag out blocks and put them inside of loops and program things with it. And when they program something like this, they see it over here on a little simulator, just like you normally would if using MakeCode with a microbit. But the added bonus is that this is what the teacher sees. So on the teacher side, the teacher can create code and share that code with students, but then also essentially the teacher can look at all of the students that are in their class. Now, I only have one student in this class, but I can look and see what each of my students is programming, and I can share their code amongst each other. I can say, oh, Melinda, I really like your code. I'm gonna share it with the whole class, and now they're gonna be working on your code. Or I can also, through a little hack that we developed, which you can learn more about in some other webinars, you can also share students' code with yourself, the teacher, and you can take their code and download it onto your robot or your board. And it sounds like that's what you guys did with Microbit Classroom. So you said you used Microbit Classroom as both a way to introduce coding and also kind of assess where they were with their coding. And right. perhaps Melinda, can you speak to like where were most of the students coming in? Did they have any experience with coding prior to this?
I think they all had experience with coding, and we knew that from the survey that was sent out beforehand, but not one had experience with Hummingbird. So, okay. So I would say they probably had experience with Scratch. I don't think they had used Microbit Classroom before, but they all felt really comfortable with drag and drop programming. They really like took to it. They didn't need much help with it. And Tina really built up to the level on the last day of that they could move into Snap and add something more complex. And some girls did and some girls didn't. So the different ages and their different experience really gave them like a lot of different options.
So Tina, you were saying that when you were introducing this, you started out with Microbit Classroom, which is what we show here, using kind of make code as the foundation, but then you moved into other programming languages and other experiences with it. So what was the next thing you did after you introduced sort of some basic coding principles with Microbit Classroom? Where'd you go from there?
Where I went from there was to show them the robot, the froggy robot, that ribbit that made a ribbit sound using make code though. That's what we, that was the programming language we used. And then I invited them to alter that code in some way. And then we downloaded that code to the frog, and maybe he ribbited more quickly, or his mouth opened and closed more quickly, or the audio was quicker or not. And then we took sort of a Microbit tour, like, so it was a kit tour, and Melinda went through each of the elements in the Hummingbird kit so that they would have an understanding of what these elements did. I think the flashcards that BirdBrain has, I think that's what you call them, flashcards, where there's just a few little steps. It illustrates what the element does, and then gives you a little, see if you can make it turn counterclockwise or whatever. And so that was a way for them to see how these elements work. We didn't give them too much guidance about building, you know, as far as what to build. And we had a really nice variety in the end because they just could use their own creativity. There was no like, okay, we're doing an animal theme. And it was quite surprising what some of the girls came up with.
Yeah. So about Froggy, if I can ask you about them for a moment, you had used Microbit Classroom with the students previously. When you transitioned to what you were describing is like the kids were at home, they were starting to get into their Hummingbird kits, but you had a robot that you had made, like I've got robots here. How were the kids controlling Froggy? What were they using?
They were using make code.
Oh, so they were using Microbit Classroom.
Yes.
Very cool. Very
yes.
Good. Okay.
And that's the part that I needed help with. It was quite a setup, I think, in the beginning, and the preparation wasn't just, I'm gonna sit down with my computer. I did have another computer, and which I logged into Microbit Classroom as a pseudo student, mm-hmm. and had, that's how we got the, and that's, that computer is what Froggy was connected to.
Sure.
So the students would share to that pseudo student.
Yeah. As a tip with that too, you don't technically need to have another computer to do that. Cause on this one, I'm logged in even in the same Chrome browser, I'm logged in as the teacher on this tab. And then I move over to the next tab and now I'm logged in as a student. So I can log in as even multiple students all on the same Chrome browser. So you can teach with Microbit Classroom just from one computer or Chromebook if you've got the bandwidth for it. You can be, being the teacher and looking at the student's code as a teacher, and also be a student or multiple students to share the code back and forth too. And right. I did want to share one other resource that Christina was talking about was the coding cards. So like here are the make code coding cards. So did you guys print these out for students?
We didn't. We sent them, we shared links to them in the chat. Melinda was really good at monitoring the chat and answering questions and providing resources, and that's how we shared that. And the students actually, I guess when they left us, did access these things. I think they were interested enough, and they're intuitive enough and very easy to understand that even our rising fifth graders had no problem following them.
Important to note that when you say rising fifth graders, that means like fourth graders who didn't really get to finish fourth grade. Because
exactly.
They had to go home. So, we recommend Hummingbird for fourth grade and up, and that's really who you were using it with, right? So that's
yes.
That's awesome. Can you guys talk about that transition from, they were using Microbit Classroom and coding your robot. You gave them the coding cards and you kind of took a tour of the Hummingbird, so they kind of learned about LEDs and motors, and then you let them design stuff. And how did that transition go from, okay, I can blink a light, to now I can make anything? How did that transition go for them?
I think one of the, and I'll let Melinda speak to this, but one of the things that we did early on was, I think it was the first day, one of the first activities was we had a list of 10 things that I showed, shared with the girls, and the 10 things were found items around the house. And I wasn't intentional about this, but I would be more intentional when I do it again. It just so happened that some of them might have been like a roll of masking tape, mm-hmm. a tissue box. So there were things that, okay, we did talk about what you can make a robot with, things around the house. So I guess that was kind of setting the scene a little bit. And they saw what I made Froggy out of, and we talked about the things that I had used. So I think that sort of helped them get the wheels rolling in that direction. Melinda, what would you add to that?
I would add that because this was a summer camp, we just had that short amount of time. So if we were, we had that amount of time, actually short or long. So if I was doing this in my classroom at school, the other thing that we're not talking about is when we logged off around 10:30 in the morning, these girls sat at their dining room tables and worked all afternoon. But they were inspired by just that little information that we gave them. And then they just sat and they started building and working. And we know that because they weren't really working with us. They kind of came to us in those last 2 days with questions, but most of the time their parents would send us an email and they would say, they're working all day. They're sitting next to me as I'm on my computer all day. They're at the dining room table building this, rolling rabbit that they're making or something. So they had a lot of time, because it was summer. So I think if you're thinking of moving this into your regular classroom, I think you would have to kind of think about the timing of that a little bit more.
True. I was talking with Dale Doherty, who's the founder of like Make Media, Make Magazine. And we were talking with him back in like March, early on in this thing. And he got real thoughtful and he was like, I think now more than any other time throughout the history of industrialized public education, kids are going to have a choice in what they do with their time, because they're not going to be shuffled from room to room. They kind of have a choice whether or not they sit down and learn with you. So what Christina was saying is like, you didn't know these kids, they weren't your high schoolers. They had no reason to come back every day, except that they were loving it and they were having a good time. And they had no reason to stay working at their dining room table all afternoon, other than that they were engaged, that they understood what was being asked of them, and they wanted to do it, and they wanted to do it more. So just like kudos to you guys for designing a program that got these girls you didn't know to know each other, like each other, and want to work on some academically rigorous stuff. Like, there's a lot of math, computational thinking, critical thinking, problem solving involved in making a robot, and especially when you make it really open-ended like that. So just congratulations to you guys for creating an amazing program.
Kelsey, can I just add something onto that? The one of the pluses of having it virtual that really came out that I think is a big plus is that the girls were home working on these things, and actually a couple of them had drawn in family members. Mm-hmm. One young girl had, you know, a brother that the next morning she would say, my brother and I were up till 11 o'clock trying to get this, you know, get this certain thing to, but, and then another one had an older sister that she, so that was a great thing. I mean, hey, what are you working on? What do you got in that box? You know, and to get family members also engaged was a happy surprise for us, because it wasn't something that we were trying to do, and we weren't asking the girls to do that at all. So
that's such a great point, that by doing this virtually, you didn't have the girls in one classroom with you. They perhaps weren't as able to work with each other as they were able to draw in their younger siblings or their older siblings. Or, you know, I was working on things this summer where I would get this girl and her grandma both joined the call, and they hadn't really seen each other or done anything together for months, but they did make this, you know, cardboard box puppet together for an hour. And then they got to like call each other and be like, grandma, I love the eyes that you drew or whatever. And it was a way for a family to engage, because either they were in the same room or just sort of a way for them to connect. So that's a really good point. What else did you find were some, let's start with advantages, but then we'll talk about challenges. What were some advantages that, other advantages that you saw in how the students learned, how they participated, what the teaching experience was like in doing this virtually? So doing robotics in person, cool, fun, awesome, doing it virtually, what were some other advantages you saw?
Well, kind of to your point that you just said, I used the Hummingbird kits at school this year with freshmen, and we had almost the same kind of situation. We had a special semester project that we could use for a week and use the kits. And we did the rover, and we did them really specific to our school, but the girls all pretty much made the same rover. You know, we looked at the instructions on Hummingbird, and they all pretty much shared their code together and did it, and we got the same result. But in this situation, and what we were talking about earlier, was that they couldn't work together. So the diversity of the end product was really different. What everybody focused on, how they built it. And, you know, Tina started with the frog. So maybe their first thought was, oh, I need to make an animal. That didn't happen for everybody, certainly not. And they really, it was so diverse versus being in a classroom with other girls that they'll look at who's next to them and they'll kind of do it the same way. So I thought that was a real plus to the virtual learning, that everyone was so creative.
So interesting. And for you teachers here on Zoom, maybe if you have had similar experiences of teaching virtually, if you've seen some other benefits to teaching virtually, like what Melinda was just saying, if I saw so much more creativity and so much more variety in students' ideas, maybe you can put some of those in the chat. I'd love to bring those into the conversation as well. Now, Melinda and Christina, you guys had described an issue that you were having with battery packs at one point, and you were kind of surprised at how your students solved it. Would either of you like to touch on that a little bit?
Go ahead, Melinda.
So these kits we had used before. I'd used them with 75 girls at the high school before COVID. And then, so they're the same kits. We send them home with them, and at least five of the girls have problems with the battery packs. And if you look at the Hummingbird battery pack, it's just a little wire and it just came undone. The first girl, I met her dad at a grocery store at like 7 o'clock at night and switched out the battery pack. But then the parents and the girls started to be like, we don't need to do this, you know? So they just all figured it out. Like the parents aren't going to drive and meet me again. They already picked up the kit from me. So the what they needed to do really was just figure out the problems. And if we were in school, that would have been my job to figure out the problem with the battery pack. They would have said, this didn't work. You know, can you get me another one? But at home, they just taped it up and figured it out, looked at it more than they would have ever looked at it at home.
Yeah, so the issue you were describing is that on some of the battery packs, they have like two wires that come out like that, and the connection just sometimes is a little bit weak. So the new ones that we've ordered are more like this, where it's just a much more strong thing. So what you found was that because your families weren't able to come pick up more stuff from you, they were just like taping stuff on there and fixing it. But since then, anybody else who has any issues like this with either battery packs or any other stuff, all of your Hummingbird is covered under a warranty for the year after you purchase it. However, there was a funky batch of battery packs. So if at any point anybody has any product difficulties, you can email us. I'll grab the email you should use here. Got a cardboard for that. You can email us info@birdbraintechnologies.com, and we can get you, if it's a battery pack, we'll just replace it. If it's any other part, we'll check and see if you're under warranty. And if you are, we'll replace it for free. So, you know, LEDs or motors or anything like that, we'll troubleshoot it with you and then replace it. So eventually you guys got all your battery packs replaced, but this camp was so short. It was just like, it was a 5-day camp, right? So right. What you found was that your girls were also just like troubleshooting for themselves in a way that you didn't see them doing when you were in class with them.
Certainly not. It's very different. You know, they have to be so much more independent at home. It works out great.
Yeah. What else were some of the, oh, go ahead, Aparna.
Yeah, Kelsey, I wanted to chime in from an interesting point, Melinda, that you brought up about these girls really taking these projects on as their own in a way that maybe in the classroom they wouldn't have. We had a webinar with another teacher, Erin Whitaker, who wasn't using one-to-one Hummingbird kits, but was making remote robots with Hummingbird this spring virtually. And she said that an interesting thing that happened with her kids is that normally, right, she would pair them up or put them in groups. And one kid out of the group would usually take over the programming. And then another kid would be building and another kid would be doing something else. But since they were virtual, they all wrote their own programs. So she was like, this is great. So everyone is getting all of the experiences because they're at home, even though she paired them up in breakout rooms, you know, they really still had to write their own program. So same kind of thing, you know, making lemonade out of lemons when you're at home, really some different experiences can happen.
Yeah. One person in the chat was wondering about that microbit classroom thing. They were wondering, hey, is there a charge for that? Nope, it's totally free. And the first time you use it, if you've never done anything with microbit or make code or anything before, it'll literally take you 5 minutes to set it up. It's so easy to use. You don't really have to know anything about coding. You don't have to know anything about make code. You'll get more familiar with it as you go. But if you just Google microbit classroom and click on the first link that comes up, it tells you everything you need to do that. Plus, there we go. So we have something on our website as well that can kind of just go over how to use microbit classroom with you as well. So this is on the remote teaching with make code. So there's a couple of different like tutorials and things on our website. And Aparna, is the best way to access that with the at home and then remote robots? Is that the best way to access that?
Yeah, right now, in fact, yeah, our apologies for the remote robots section of the website. So if you guys have been tuning in, it seems like every month we are developing some new way to use our products remotely. And so the first thing that happens is we put up a page with a lot of information on it as we're doing it. So really this stuff is coming out like literally this week, we put up a page about using Finch robots remotely. And so it's brand new. So hopefully in the next week, we're gonna rearrange those pages so they're a little bit more user-friendly and you can find the microbit classroom as well as building your own Hummingbird remote robot, using Finch robots remotely, or teaching one-to-one virtually. So all of those are different options for using our products virtually. All the pages are there now. So I'm putting them in the chat. If you want to know, stick your question in there. I'll give you the direct link if it's not so easy to find yet. But yes, literally we are sketching up a better way to find them on the website as we speak.
And again, a huge kudos to Melinda and Christina, who like the minute we would release something, they'd be like, yep, we're doing it. Like, right, they were just like on the cutting edge of what was possible with remote robotics as it pertains to Hummingbird. You guys were on the cutting edge of that and just like fearless in bringing this to your students. So just like, awesome, awesome stuff. So how about-
Fearless or foolish, I'm not sure which one.
You know, a little column A, a little column B, and that's how we like our teachers, so. So could you guys perhaps speak to, we talked about some of the advantages, especially the unexpected advantages to teaching virtually as opposed to teaching this in the classroom. But what were some of the challenges that you faced when teaching this virtually?
What comes to mind very quickly is you did such a nice, graceful job in the beginning of this webinar of setting some ground rules. And because Melinda and I were like, yeah, I want this to feel like so much like a classroom and like we're the teacher and they're gonna get in trouble. So we kind of were a little bit loose with classroom rules. But by about day three, we realized that it was kind of a necessity and we weren't gonna scare anybody off by saying, you know, please mute yourself if the dog comes in the room, and please you know ask before you present something, right. That kind of thing. So that was a challenge. Once we got a handle on, I think our roles became very much more delineated as we went, even after the first day, because it was necessary when someone needed some help or to troubleshoot something, and it wasn't to the benefit of all of the girls. And then in some cases, they would run into a problem where it benefited everyone to, hey, check this out, even if they weren't having that problem. But sometimes it wasn't necessary, and it just held people back if we just put all of our attention on one. So having this, the ability to have like a breakout room, and that was sort of Melinda's territory to, you know, sort of take them aside. And sometimes Melinda will tell you, it was just like, they just wanted attention, you know, like they really didn't have a problem. They just wanted to be the center of attention. Mind you, they're in fourth grade. So, you know, totally understandable. But those are two easily solved, I think, challenges. What else, Melinda?
Yeah, I think that was probably the biggest challenge was how we were going to figure out how to troubleshoot these things, like the battery pack, like when your LED's not blinking, you know, all the things that you know and you could easily help a kid with in front of you. So we did on that like third day figure out, oh, I can take them out of this room and we can go do it together. And that I was just reading the chat while Tina was leading the class. So I was really kind of doing that management when she was leading the class. So that was a thing we kind of had to learn. And I guess everybody sort of learned that by now, but when we were doing it, it was kind of new for us to really have two, that I was the assistant in the class and Tina was the instructor, and I made sure things, you know, could keep moving along if there was a problem. So that helped.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, I was just going to call it like the just to overview those three things of having some other adult on the call with you so that they can pop into a breakout room with a kid. And you guys only had 10 kids on your Zoom, right?
Right.
Having somebody extra there, that whether it's a behavior issue or a troubleshooting issue, or I mean, so many of our kids are dealing with like depression, anxiety, isolation. So like just having somebody who can pop into a room and check in. So that, because as you know, probably by now on Zoom, you can't have a one-on-one conversation on Zoom because everybody can see you all the time. And that's its own sort of fatigue. So like having an extra adult on there, and I know that's not practical for every single teacher, but you have networks, you got people. Can you get parent volunteers to come into the class with you? Do you have a co-teacher you could work with? Could you get some of your high schoolers who are looking for volunteer hours, and how the heck do you volunteer during COVID? Could you work something out with the high school where high schoolers come in and they volunteer to help with troubleshooting and some of that socio-emotional support, right? Do you have a specialist teacher who could pop in with you on a couple of days while you're doing this? Just having an extra adult in the room with you to go to a breakout room, or to, exactly like Melinda was saying, also monitor the chat. Aparna is doing that with me today. She's taking a look at that chat and calling things out and answering questions there so that we can be really active on the chat together. And I can be fully engaged in talking with everybody who's here on Zoom as well. So just knowing that Aparna's got my back and she's like monitoring that, it just like lets me concentrate here and be a teacher, right? So that's so important too. There's a couple things that I'm seeing coming in from the chat actually. I think Michael was talking about him using a webcam as an overhead view. Michael, do you wanna share about that? That's a teaching technique that's working for you. And you're muted, do you wanna unmute?
Got it. Okay, yeah, I just started using it. It's sort of an experiment and found that I can focus within 6 to 8 inches for fine details when I'm doing, you know, wiring instructions and coding instructions. And I can actually use the webcam for instructions on the iPad. It's amazing. So I don't have to switch back and forth. It's a really great tool. Unfortunately, right now, webcams are in great demand online. So finding one that's quality is really difficult. Fortunately, I had a friend that lent me his, but it's really amazing. It's a game changer for me.
Just being able to switch to another camera and show you, like, okay, now you got to flip it over to do this. Yeah. This is a finch, not a hummingbird, obviously, but you know, just being able to show folks stuff like that is really important. Melinda and Christina, did you guys have a multi-camera setup for when you were teaching?
I did actually, with that other device that I had, and I kind of knew that I could go to a different tab and be a student and still, but I wasn't savvy enough to figure out how to do that and still keep the whole Zoom call like in front of me, because I wanted to be able to see the students, et cetera. So we had the two, but I did have a webcam connected to the other device, which made it a lot better visually to show the robots functioning.
Yeah. So you could take a couple different approaches with it. You could attach a webcam to your camera and then through the same Zoom account be switching cameras, or you could zoom in from a second device. Renata just said that she would also zoom in from her phone. So she could just sort of, you can choose, as I'm doing today, which thing to spotlight. So sometimes, you know, she would spotlight herself so that she could be making eye contact with the students. Sometimes she would spotlight her phone, which was, she was able to use more like a document camera. So there's lots of great ways to solve some of those problems. But I wanna open things up. I'm gonna get out of spotlight view here, because I wanna open things up to you teachers who are here on Zoom today. What questions do you guys have for Christina and Melinda? Looks like Michael's got one. Do you wanna unmute and start us off, Michael?
My question was for you, Kelsey. What do you use for your overhead view?
So we have a slightly more complicated system here. What we use here is we use a number of different cameras that are like sort of professional quality cameras. And we then turn the camera feed into a webcam feed. And then we use a system called OBS, which allows us to do things like split screen. We just use hotkeys. So it's not super complicated to use. OBS stands for Open Broadcast System. It's free online software. There is a little bit of a learning curve with it, but setting it up does make teaching really easy, because we can switch between all the different cameras that we've got here. We can split screen different things. I can split screen here and here, right? So it gives us a lot of capabilities here to do like basically live video editing with all of our different cameras here. But I will say, you don't need a nice fancy camera. We wanted to set this place up so that it kind of looks like a TV studio. Like this is not a virtual backdrop, right? Like we built it for this purpose, but you don't need this. This is sort of like the high ceiling, but the low floor is like, get a $30 webcam that plugs into your USB port, make a stand for it out of an Amazon box, or clip it onto a coat rack or a lamp or something. Like you don't need a lot of expensive equipment. The low floor maybe costs $30 in an Amazon box, and a little bit of, like, pun mildly intended, outside the box thinking.
I'm showing my camera holder up there.
Let's show that off. So he's got a nice little camera holder. That's fancy.
Yeah, I'm just learning CNC, so I made mine on a CNC machine.
Very nice. Absolutely. I can't see the person's name, but they asked Christina and Melinda if they could talk a little bit more about how to build relationships and share some cool final projects or learning experiences. We'll start with that first part. How did you guys build those relationships with the students and encourage them to build relationships with each other?
I think because it was called Pechakucha, and I explained to the girls what it meant in Japanese, I sort of encouraged them to come each day with something about themselves or their world that would be interesting to someone else. And we started by sharing about ourselves a little bit. I think Melinda's dog made an appearance and, some things like that. It was very quick. It was only 5 days, and these girls came from varying backgrounds, not even from the same schools. I think the group represented seven different schools. So with 10 students, seven different schools, they didn't even have that in common.
Yeah.
I don't think that we had a plan on forging relationships with them. We just wanted them to feel comfortable sharing a little bit of time in their day with other people. I think sometimes you're lucky when the chemistry of a group works. And I don't know if we got enthusiastic students. They were kind to each other. They were supportive of each other. I'd love to say it was something that Melinda and I did, but I don't think so. We just got lucky, and the chemistry of the group worked. When somebody showed something or made a mechanism work, they got like all kinds of applause and thumbs up from the rest of the girls. And we modeled that, but certainly we didn't have anything specific, I'm sorry to say, unless.
I would say that you're not saying about how much you put into planning the week and how you did have fun things every day for them. Like you said, it was not like a classroom. We weren't trying to make it like a classroom, and you played different games with them. Like we had like breaks and that scavenger hunt in the beginning, like all of that was really fun, and it built camaraderie with the girls, I think. Even though you're like, well, some of those things didn't work great, they worked well enough that they built it. So there was at least a game every day, and there was that talking in the beginning. So it was just like how you'd build camaraderie in your classroom. It kind of worked the same way.
Yeah. There's a game that I'll share. Maybe others might like to explore it. It's called Draw Phone. And the players are asked to draw something, and then the rest of the players have to guess what it is. So it's you're constantly like scrolling through drawings, and then you have to quickly identify, I think that's a flower, but you're drawing using your device. So sometimes they look pretty wacky. This was, I'm trying to think of his name. The software for this game was written by, his name's Tanner Krusen. And he's also written other digital games that can be played virtually. So check him out. It's called Draw Phone. And it is kind of fun. So that might be a good, and then they were laughing at each other's drawings. So that sometimes breaks the ice a little bit.
You know, and it sounds like something that I've heard versions of from different teachers, that work that you do at the beginning of the school year to get to know your students' names, make sure you're pronouncing them correctly, setting classroom norms, that is just as important virtually as it was in the classroom. And in some cases, perhaps even more important because they kind of know how classrooms work, but here you have to teach them how to play. You have to teach them and model for them what engagement looks like. Does engagement look like this? Does engagement look like using these little emojis down there to put those up on your screen if you've got your video off? Does engagement look like if somebody is having an emotional day, maybe you get some hand signals, like this is one that I like, if somebody's sharing something emotional, like I'm with you, I hear you, right? Because like crying in a classroom full of people who love you is an experience, and crying on a Zoom full of people who don't know you is a whole different experience. I'm like, right? But how can we, and it sounds like what you guys did is you prioritized fun, that this wasn't, they weren't being graded on any of this. Grades, I would contend, have never mattered less than they do right now, right? But like connection matters now. And that's what you guys were facilitating: fun, connection, inquiry, self-directed learning, connecting with the other people on the call and connecting with their families, and ingenuity. And you guys were also modeling that. So it sounds like you guys were just naturally really good at modeling that for your students, and that your students came in wanting that. But for other teachers who are thinking about trying to set something like this up, how can you intentionally create activities, experiences for students where you're modeling what support looks like, what connection looks like, what participation and engagement look like? Yeah, Parna.
And Tina, you mentioned having a scavenger hunt. We've had other teachers who've taught virtually with Hummingbird in the past 6 months also use scavenger hunts. And so they'll say, you know, this part of your Hummingbird kit, go find something in your house that has an LED in it. Or they're making mechanisms, like, can you find this mechanism somewhere in your house? And it provides first an opportunity for students to choose to share something about their environment. So they get to choose, they can show it, but they're, you know, purposely, it's not like our backgrounds where it's sometimes not in your control. They're choosing what they're sharing about themselves, but it's really personal because it's in their house. And second, it gets the kids up and moving and not just sitting. And of course, building with the Hummingbird will do that. But, you know, that's always something fantastic to be able to build in just because of the sheer number of hours all of us are sitting in front of our screens.
Right. One thing, and you remind me that sharing something about themselves, that's one of the things I think that virtually is a benefit to an in-person in a way, because some kids might feel inhibited in person, but if they have a screen that they have the choice to mute or to go off camera for a minute, they might feel more comfortable to share who they are. I will say also, because we were a little lax on classroom rules in the beginning, the very first day, and we had these, you know, aspirations, like we're gonna have chit chat and the girls are gonna tell a little something. Well, many of them that first day, right, Melinda had like cameras off, muted. So I'd be asking questions, like trying to get them, hey, did anybody, and I got nothing. I can't see their faces. I can't read the room at all. So, but I would say by the second-ish day, everybody was showing themselves and very enthusiastic about doing that. So I just wanted to share that.
Yeah, we had one other question in the chat, and I'm conscious that our time is short, but one question in the chat, they were thinking about how are they going to do a showcase? So I thought that would be something good to end on. This is a picture that's featured in this case study, and I'll hold this URL up again so that if anybody who hasn't opened it, you can. But what can you tell us about this little robot we're looking at right here? What is it, who made it, and how did it work?
So one of the girls in the class made it, and she's the one who worked with her brother like up until 11 o'clock at night. And it's an owl bat because she wanted it to be an owl. And then they were like, her family was like, I think that's a bat. So, and her mom said, you know, she had me running out to Michael's, you know, even though we didn't tell them to go to Michael's, like she needed me to get felt for the eyes, you know? So what we did on the last day was the girls all showed their work to us, and then and they showed how they did it, and they talked about it just like how I'm talking about it. And then Tina encouraged them all to send a robot profile. So if you want to talk about that, Tina, because I thought that was a great way to showcase it.
Sure. They all sent a photograph of their robot and a description like who the engineer was, what the robot's name was, what elements of the Hummingbird kit did you use, and what does your robot do? And then we just made a little PDF of all the pictures and the descriptions and made that available to all of the families. We emailed it to them, and then I think Melinda made it available to school. But can I just show one that, this one blew us away because we were very open-ended about what to build. And one of our girls made this.
Oh my goodness.
And the bird, the seagull moved, the wave moved, and I think she might have had an LED behind the sun, I'm not sure, but it was just really neat to see them go the extra mile.
Yeah, that's amazing. I'm gonna go to gallery view here real quick, and can we all give Melinda, Christina, and their students a round of applause if you've got your camera on? Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful teaching and learning, everybody at your school. Congratulations, and thank you guys for sharing it with us.
Thank you so much for inviting us.
For anybody who didn't catch it before, here's that URL so that you can check out their case study, learn more. You can find some more case studies on our website, on the Bird Brain website, if you go to our robotics at home page. So birdbraintechnologies.com/robotics@home. There's a few other case studies on there that you might find interesting. If you have any questions about anything, or if you also had a battery pack malfunction and you need a new one, or for anything else, or perhaps if you have a case study of, I taught Hummingbird with my students this summer and here's how it went, please email us info@birdbraintechnologies.com. We'll connect you with the right person at our hearty little company, and we will, we'd love to feature you as well. And then finally, please connect with us on social media, on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. We sometimes go live with our videos on Facebook, so you may be watching us there now, but you can like us and subscribe to us and things like that so that you can keep up with all of the innovative things that teachers are doing, because as we mentioned, we are producing content at an alarming rate to help teachers learn to and execute teaching robots remotely. And as Melinda and Christina did, if you follow us closely, you can be on the cutting edge of what is possible with remote robotics. So once again, thank you so much to Melinda and Christina for joining us today. You guys are amazing educators, and I'm so thankful that you're part of the Bird Brain family. So thank you both. All right, we will end our live stream there. If anybody else would like to hang out on the Zoom call for a little bit.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We can't wait to see what you make on social media. On Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, you can tag @BirdBrainTech or #HummingbirdKit, or you can even tag me. If you have any questions, be sure to email us, info@birdbraintechnologies.com. We can answer questions about purchasing, about learning, about teaching, and about professional development. If you haven't been there yet, be sure to visit our Robotics at Home page. There you can purchase a kit for yourself, learn how to use it, and even join one of our upcoming webinars. Until we see you in class, thanks for watching from everyone at Bird Brain Technologies.